Our subject today is signs of the end. Signs of the end. We live in a very deceptive age. In fact, deceptions of all sorts are all around us. And as I think, I remember, that's what Jesus said. The very first sign he says of the end is, be not deceived. Why would he say that? In fact, isn't it true that that second beast of Revelation 13 deceiveth those that dwell on the earth? Signifying that place from which he came. So the deceptions are the order of the day. Let's take the news for example. Do you believe everything you hear? Do you realize that there are many things you hear on the news that are really not so? It's interesting because back home, the cops are scared half to death because of the new technology called camera phones. Did you know that? I see it taking place here too. But I just remember something recently happening where, you know, the news tells you, you always hear this, you know, a man attacked the police did this, you know. So this was something similar, you know, how that this man attacked the police with a machete and the police in self-defense killed the man. And you've heard that all your life, so you're just saying, that's a crazy guy, isn't he? Attack a police with a machete? 3 days later, a video emerged that gave the true story. Oh, it was far different than the news said it was. And the video, that video just, without any sound, you could see that this man was killed in cold blood. So, what I'm saying, there are things happening in our world that when you hear them, you have to wonder, should I believe this? Let me give you an example, since the entire world was involved in this one. On March 8, a flight disappeared. Do you remember that? Malaysian Airline 370. And they said, we don't know what happened. $100 million were spent trying to search out the Southern Indian Ocean. Is that where it was? And to this day, not a sound. Where did that plane go? Wow. I mean, it still is amazing many. Isn't that true? But the truth is, and I am not a conspiracy theorist. I am not. The truth is, those who were hearing news from the right sources actually knew where the plane was the next day. But most people don't. So they say, well, that's what they tell us. That's what they tell us. And see, we don't know anything. And that's as far as it goes. But what if I said to you, I know where the plane went. I know exactly what. What if I said something more? What if I said to you, hey, you remember that flight M17, the one that was shot down over Ukraine? What if I said to you, that's the same plane, went back in the sky with the dead bodies and was shot out of the sky? What would you say? Come on. I don't even know this guy. Who is he anyway? Why would I listen to him? What if I said to you that Ebola is just a scare tactic to lead you to this big vaccination campaign that is coming? What would you say? What if I said the numbers are doctored and it's not true? Well, brother, that's your opinion, you know. It's okay. Well, all I'm saying is that for you to actually begin trusting, listening, and believing, you must first have confidence in your source. Is that true? Would you agree? Come on, talk to me. Yes. So first you trust your news source. You trust your news source. And then when I see, if I really want to deceive you, if I really want to deceive you, if I really want to swindle you out of some money, Janet, then I won't just come and get at you and your bank account. So tell me, where do you keep your money? Tell me, I'll become your friend. Somebody you can trust. And when I know I have your confidence and your trust, then I can make my move. Isn't that right? And we think the devil is more like after you that way. No, he comes. He wants to be your friend. He wants you to feel comfortable and feel at ease and feel at home. And then he makes his move. All right. So our subject then is dealing with the signs of the signs of the end, signs of the times, still good. All right, signs brings confirmation to prophecy, prediction, or claim. Would you agree with that? Okay, I'll say that again. I don't want you to forget. Signs brings confirmation to prophecy, prediction, or claim, right? So if I tell you something is going to happen, I'll give you a sign so that you'll know when. Okay? I went to meet somebody a couple of days before. He never met me. And he said, "Now, how would I know you?" I said, "I'm driving a blue pickup truck." And he said, "Oh, okay, fine." So the moment I went in the parking lot, this guy walked towards the vehicle. I didn't know him. But the moment he did, I said, "This is the guy." Why? He was following the sign. Okay. Now, I'm going to ask you to read with me a passage here in Matthew chapter 16. And I want us to examine a couple of things said here in Matthew 16. And I'm going to take the first four verses from Matthew 16. First four verses, Matthew 16, beginning in verse 1. And you know me, I like when you read together. I like when we read along. Is that good? Yes, and then, you know, if you're ever feeling sleepy, then, you know, by reading, you're kept awake, right? I doubt you'll sleep, but let's see. Verse 1, are we there? Let's go. The Pharisees also, with the Sadducees, and tempting him, desired him that he would show them a sign from heaven. Let's go on. And he, Jesus, answered and said unto them, "When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, can you discern the sign, the face of the sky, but can he not discern the signs of the times?" Verse 4. "A wicked and idolatrous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it, but the sign of whom? The prophet Jonas." All right. Now, I want you to think about the scenario that we're just looking at here. These people wanted a sign. A sign for him to show them that he is who he claims to be. Not just a normal sign. They said, "Show us a sign from where, beloved?"
Heaven.
From heaven. They wanted a sign from heaven. I guess they had the history of Samuel calling down thunder and rain, and Moses calling manna from heaven, and Elijah calling fire from heaven. "Show us a sign from heaven to tell us who you are." So they wanted a sign from heaven. Now Jesus says, "There shall no sign be given you except what, beloved? The sign of who? What is the sign of the prophet Jonas?" As it said, as the New Testament uses it there. Go to chapter 12 of Matthew. Matthew chapter 12, And let's take a couple of verses, starting in verse 38. Let's start in 38, we go to 40. Let's go together. Then certain of the scribes and Pharisees, similar picture, answered saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. But he answered and said unto them, same thing, an evil and idolatrous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but what? The sign of the prophet Jonas. Verse 40, this is the sign of the prophet Jonas. You agree? Let's look at it. For as Jonah was in the 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights. Where? All right. So let me ask you: Do you suppose then, when Jesus died and was resurrected, all the Pharisees and scribes believed on him? Wouldn't you say that? I mean, come on, if you ask me for a sign, I say, listen, this is the sign. This is my sign. When the Son of Man shall be 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the earth, that's your sign. And you see it come to pass. You see it fulfilled. Wouldn't you then agree that this is the person? Wouldn't you agree? Wouldn't you say this was enough and sufficient? All right. So then, let me ask you. Did all the scribes and Pharisees convert to Christianity at the death of Christ? But why? That's a strange one. And could it be the same today? Is it possible that you and I in this room and all those who are hearing, is it possible that you are actually in the same place as the scribes and Pharisees? All right, what we're going to be doing today is very simple. What we're going to be doing, we're going to be going back to what Jesus says would be the signs of his coming. We're going to look and see if these are really happening and then to see how that applies to me and you. And then we're over. Isn't that simple? I think so too. All right, let's go to a verse in 1 John. No, that's 1 Peter, not John. It should be 1 Peter. That's right. 1 Peter, 1 Peter chapter 4. Peter. Let's read verse 7 together. 1 Peter 4 and verse 7. Together, let's go. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore what? Sober and watch unto prayer. Now let me ask you. Think about what he's saying. He says the end of all things is at hand. Jesus went to preach about the kingdom. Where did he say it was? At hand, right? When he was preaching, he said, it's at hand. The disciples, it's at hand. What did he mean? Was it here or near? At hand mean it's really close, right? I mean, that's my understanding. At arm's length, it's at hand. It's here coming. All right. So he says, the end of all things, Peter says, is at hand. And then he says, here's what he's admonishing us to do. He says, be what? Sober and watch unto prayer. To be sober means what? What's the opposite of sober? Drunk. Okay. Interesting. Can you describe darkness without light? Using the word light. Can you? Blackness. Okay. All right. So, what does it mean to be drunk? Let's see if we can get that first. What does it mean to be drunk? All right. Intoxicated meaning what? All right. So, you have wrong perceptions of reality. You says not able to think properly. Your senses are impaired. Wouldn't you say? Wouldn't you agree with that? To be drunk means to have a distorted view. of reality. So you think you're falling, you think you're straight when you're lean. Have you ever seen drunk? I mean, come on, you've seen drunks, right? And you can't, I mean, isn't that true what the policeman does? He gives you a straight line to walk on. And you're going straight, but in a wrong way, right? Then he says, what I'm asking you to do is to be sober. In other words, you need to have a correct perspective, not a distorted view now, but a correct perspective of reality. So where we are and the things that are happening are necessary in preparing us for this. That's what he's saying. And then he says, watch. Is that what he says? On to prayer. Keep your spiritual focus always on what is happening. And we're going to come back to this watch later on. All right. I want you to look at two verses with me quickly. Go to Luke chapter 21. Luke 21. Now I'm going to do this so to move a little quicker. I see time is going fast. On this side, please. Luke 21, 38. On this side, could you find Mark 13, 29? Luke 21, over here, Luke 21, 38, on my right, Mark 13, 29. Are we ready with Luke? Let's go. Luke.
All the people came early in the morning to him in the temple for to hear him.
I'm sorry, what are you reading?
Luke 21, 38.
Try 28. Luke 21, 28. Let's see if 28 works.
Okay.
Let's go together.
And when these things begin,
that sounds like it, yes.
To pass, uh-huh. Then look up.
Yes.
And lift up your heads, mm-hmm. For your redemption draweth nigh.
Okay. Keep that in mind. Mark 13, 29. We have that one?
Yep.
Let's go.
So
you. Okay, so Matthew says, when these things begin to come to pass, you are to
look up.
Mark says, when you shall see these things come to pass, then you are to know what?
It is nigh,
even at the door. So my question then is, what are you looking for? What are you looking for? Because it's the only time you will see. I actually have this presentation in a PowerPoint format, but then I have a lot of clips, actual audio clips, so I decided not to use it. But in that format, I have what is called an awareness test. Some of you are probably aware of this with a group of guys, and you were told specifically, look at what is happening here, count this, and you do, and then, did you see this? No. Rewind, look again. How did I not see it? Well, just based on what you're looking for. Easy. Just tell somebody what to look for, and then they're looking just for what you say, and not necessarily for the other things that are going by, right? And I think this is what Jesus is saying. If you get distracted, you might not see it. If you get distracted, then it might be that certain things are happening, but because your eyes are not there, because you're not looking for this, you miss it. Right? Okay. All right, so question then, when will the end come and what will be the signs? And then and what I'm going to be doing is really just familiar ground that we'll be going over. In fact, you know the three passages, Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, and some parts of 17, actually deals with this issue of the end, what he says will happen, and how it will take place. In fact, I'm sure you're familiar with the destruction of Jerusalem, right? Not one stone will be left on another. And also the coming of Christ, the end of the world. Look, the question was kind of threefold. Tell us, Master, when shall these things be? What shall be the sign of thy coming and the end of the world? That's what he's dealing with in these passages. Okay, now that is said, let's go on. First thing he says, verse 4, Matthew 24, he says, and be not deceived. Let me just stop for a moment and say this. Folks who are deceived don't know that they're deceived, or they would not be deceived. Come on. People don't just go around and say, I'm looking for a deception to fall into. So when somebody's deceived and honestly deceived, it's your duty to help that person in bringing light to this person. Oh, we're so quick to quote that verse. Oh, Ephraim is joined to his idols, let him alone. And that's true. But not until evidences are produced to help in that way. See the point? Yeah. So, you know, we normally say, it's a strange, strange thing. Back home in Jamaica, and a few of you here have been there, where we worship, our worship place is just below the Adventist church on top of the hill. I was an elder up there. And it's interesting. Here we are in this little place, and they're on top of the hill, and they have these speakers, you know, when they're and they're saying, them down there are lost! Okay, and then the same people that says this, they pass us and say, hello. Now, does that make sense to you? You know that we are lost. Nobody ever came to the lost people to say, listen, I need to straighten you guys out. Well, that's just my experience. I'm just saying, think about what you're doing and the people you mingle with and the people you actually say, yeah, he's kind of gone, you know, and that's that sort of thing. And see if that really is helping. No, it's not. You are the light of the world. Come on, you're a city set on a hill. Start shining. Verse 5. So remember, it's simple. We're just going to be going through this. Come on with me. And we're just going to be asking some questions, looking at the things that are happening and see if what he actually said back then is taking place now. And if it is, then we or I should be wide awake because something is happening and the end is really here, right upon us. And maybe we're not aware. Verse 5. We there? Matthew 24. Let's look at verse 5. What does it say?
For many shall come in my name.
Mm-hmm. In fact, let's just join the two together, 4 and 5, and see what it's saying. And Jesus answered together. Are we good? Are we there? And Jesus answered and said unto them, what? Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying what? I am Christ and shall deceive many. Now look at what the word says, and it's clear what it says. It says many shall come in his name. And most times, that's all we see. We say, people will come in the name of Jesus and saying this in the name of Jesus. That's not what the verse is saying. We miss that phrase. They shall come in my name saying what? I am Christ. This is 2014, it's September. Let me ask you, do you know of anybody on the planet today, on the planet, that claims to be Christ? Again, I said I had videos of that I could show you, but I'll just call some name and see if they ring a bell. There's a guy down who started down in Miami in a warehouse down there called Jose Miranda. He's from Puerto Rico. And he claims to be Jesus. I mean, I have Fox clips, CNN. They did interviews with him on these trusted stations, right? And this is his claim. He has followers in the thousands. In fact, their followers, his followers, now tattoos 666 all over their bodies. Because he says, you think Antichrist is a bad thing? It's not. All right. There is another man in Serbia somewhere that his name is what? Sergei Thorup. I think it was some traffic cop in Russia somewhere. But he claims, they call him, is that Russian word for teacher? Vasilian or Vasilian? Whatever it is. That's his name. He has a gathering of like 5,000 there in the hills of Serbia. There is another one down in the Philippines called Pastor Quibaloy. He has a following in the 6 million counting. He claims that the official coming of the Son of God took place in April 13, 2005. He proclaims himself to be Jesus on earth. Then down under, that's right, is A.J. Miller up in Queensland area. He has a compound up there with over 5,000 too. And he claims to be Jesus. He's married to a woman called Mary Magdalene. He says, I didn't know that. I'm simply saying what Jesus said is being fulfilled before our eyes. We're probably not aware of it, but it's happening. So at least, how many do we count? Jose, Kibloy, Vasilian, four. And there's one in Brazil. See? So I'm simply saying, just look at what he's saying. I'm simply saying, I was thinking, impossible. Nobody will ever claim this. And there are people, some people today that says, I don't believe that, right? Okay, it's all right. But I'm simply saying, look at what Jesus says. Then you'll know that the things he's saying are coming to pass and they're happening right now as we speak. But let's go on. I wanted to just look at a couple of verses quickly. Go down a little further in Matthew 24. Let's look at three verses. I'll read these for you. Verse 24, 25, 26. He says, "For there shall arise false Christ," Matthew 24, 24, "and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, what would happen? They shall deceive who? The very elect. Behold, I told you before." Interesting. "Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in Australia, Serbia, or Texas, or Brazil, go not forth. Behold, he is in the bride chamber, don't go there. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west," what will happen, beloved? "So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." Hallelujah. So here we have something that is solid. So it's not for you to say, okay, let me go down there and hear what he's teaching. He's saying, don't go. I wonder why he says, don't go.
You should be deceived.
Interesting. Anyway, so let's go on. I'm going to ask you to read for me two passages. One is over in Luke and one is in Matthew. All right, so since we're in Matthew 24, let's start there. And then we'll go to Luke 21. I just want to do a quick comparison and just ask you if you see a difference with these two passages. Let me just get to where I want to be quickly. And then, all right, let's start in verse 6. Matthew 24, 6. Let's go down to verse 6 to 9. We're there? Matthew 24, 6 to 9. What does it say there, beloved? "And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet." Let's go on. "For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdoms against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in different places. All these are the beginning of sorrows." 9. "Then shall they do what? Deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake." All right. So, just keep a mental picture of what you just read. Okay? Let's go over to chapter 21 in Luke now, and let's see if we can make a comparison to what is being said. Let's start in verse 9, Luke 21. And let's start in verse 9. Basically saying the same thing. There is a phrase used by Luke that was not used by Matthew. I just want to ask for you to look for it and see if you catch it. Verse 9, be there? Let's go. "But when you shall hear of" what? "Wars and commotions, be not terrified, for these must first come to pass, but the end is not by and by." Sounds similar to what we read. "Then he said unto them, nations shall rise against, and kingdom against, and great earthquakes shall there be in diverse places, and famines, and pestilences, and fearful sights, and great signs shall there be from heaven." Verse 12, But before all these, they shall lay hand on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and into prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. Did you catch it? It's a lot of reading. Let me see the brilliant person that caught that element that was missing. Pat. All right. That's good. Before all things, all these. All right. Great. So two brilliant students in the class today, and I'm very happy for that. And then he has helped us all here in seeing those two things. Notice what he says. He brought something. Luke brought something in the narrative that was different. He says, there shall be fearful sights and great signs shall there be where?
From heaven.
And then the next part the first part of verse 12 actually says something that is very essential to what we're looking at. But before all these, I'm going to repeat it. Do you see it in your Bible? He says, but before all these what? Okay, signs, right? Oh, just what he said before. Wouldn't you agree? So he's saying, look for these things. But he says, look, before all these things begin to happen, which are simply this, great earthquake in different places, famine and pestilence, and fearful sights and great signs from the heaven. Before these actually come to pass, certain things must happen first. Am I misinterpreting what I'm reading? No. Okay, so you're in agreement then so far that what is necessary is for certain things to take place before you look for these signs. All right, let's take, for example, wars. There has always been war. Jesus says that will always happen. He says, this is not the end. When you see this happening, it's really not the end. All right, and there's always famines and all these things taking place. Always, somewhere. I mean, natural disasters, so. These are always happening, but he says, this is just nothing to think about right now. But then he says, here is something that you are to look for. He says, when you see persecution taking place, am I correct in that? Read verse 9 again. I just want to be sure that we're saying the right thing. Verse 9. But before... No, sorry, 12. I'm sorry. Verse 12. I'm sorry. Yes. But before, verse 12, yes. But before all these, what will happen? Mm-hmm. Yes. We're getting tired. I recognize. Yeah, so persecution takes place. Who is he talking about? Who will be persecuted? Who? The Hindus? Who will be persecuted? All right. So the people of God will be persecuted. Who are those? Are we saying Christians? Christians. In that, I mean, why will they be persecuted according to Matthew? For my name's sake. Is that what he says? All right. So let me ask, what is persecution? I mean, we use the word and we kind of have an idea what it might mean, but what is persecution? Ever thought of it? Yes, you're right. Hostility or ill treatment, mistreatment, to, especially because of race, practice, belief, in fact, I think political or religious belief, or simply oppression. Now, I'm going to ask you then to think about what's been happening in the world today. And it's easy to say, my church has not been persecuted, brother, so it could not be the meaning. It's easy, right? Because I grew up with this. God, I mean, I just thank God for breaking the chains that held me in that kind of belief. Where, you know, you go to a church, the first thing they do, they convince you, they bring you to that place of trust. And they say, we are God's remnant church. Right? And then that sink in your psyche. And if you've been a part of this since you were in your mother's belly, come on, that's deep. This is God's remnant church, and everything else will fall, we will stand. Everybody else's falls, and one day God is going to do something. He says, other sheep which are not of this fold, them will I also bring into my fold, into my church, and they were going to have one church. That's not what the Bible says. That's what we get from what it says. So when you look at this, you're thinking, my church has not been persecuted and we are the only true Christians. Don't you know? We are the only true Christians and my church has not been persecuted. So I don't see that as a sign. Come on, I don't. But here the word is telling us something. It's simply saying that when you shall see this happen and begins to happen, then you're going to see the signs begin to follow. Does that make sense to you? I hope it does. It is now declared that Christianity is the most persecuted religion on the planet.
Yeah, that's right.
Linford and I went to India back in 2003. And we were having some good meetings in the southern part of India. And we went up a couple of states up and had some meetings there. And I remember the first meeting we had, this was an area where you had the radical Hindus, these that will kill for their religion. Strangely enough, we after that first meeting, and it was a good meeting. We had a good turnout, you know. I was doing the presentation. We had some tassels with a few people that were there. And it was well covered. We had newspaper stations and different people there, cameras and so. But it was okay. Then we closed for lunch. We were off to a late start. We closed for lunch and then we should resume in the afternoon. So the host, the people that were hosting this thing said, those guys were the radicals. We got to go. Let's go. Man, we left lunch. We didn't eat. We went in the car and we headed back south because these radicals were there. Well, I've asked them to forgive me because my faith was weak. And I really don't look at it and say, man, and you are talking about faith? I mean, I just look at it and say, why did I listen? Why didn't we just say, well, let's see what God does? Well, maybe our faith weren't there, right, Lynn? And so, well, see, I have company. So we weren't there. So we went away. We ran away. We went back down south. We spent that week in a motel. And then we were thinking there, well, we should have stayed. And then we called the guy and said, all right, we're going to come back on a train. And it just didn't work out. But I'm simply saying how easy sometimes we get alarmed by what we perceive to be danger, not seeing or perceiving the angels of God around you, that it encamps around you and delivers you. I mean, we don't see that because maybe we were not looking in that direction. Okay, so we were young and I'm sure he just looks and he pats us on the shoulder and he says, come on, get up and let's go again. All right. But Jesus says, when you shall see this take place, then begin to look. The news is full of what's taking place in the world. It somehow seems like there is a radical movement on the planet that is moving at such rapid speed that I think even the governments are afraid. We hear of ISIS, ISIL, IS. Who are they? All right, so your president says, I just want you to know, these are not Muslims. Okay. And you say, did you hear that, Jen? Did you hear that? Our president says, these are not Muslims.
Who does he say they are?
These are people pretending to be Muslims because they're killing Muslims. Isn't that what he said? Didn't you hear? you don't listen. But think about this for a moment. This radical movement has been killing Christians by the thousands. Is that true? But you say, stop a moment. Who are these people? Oh, they're Catholics. Oh, they're Orthodox. What does it matter? This is happening. This is not happening just in these Muslim countries. This has been happening in Africa. This has been happening in India. I mean, they have been killing Christians, roasting Christians. I mean, lighting communities, entire villages. I have graphic pictures of these things taking place. Beheadings. I mean, all these things are taking place against Christ. But the Christians, we just say, well, maybe if they were a part of our movement, that then that probably wouldn't happen, you know? Just because they don't know the true God. What do you think? They should have known the true God, and maybe they would have been preserved. I'm sure you're familiar with Daniel 11. And it's beautiful how that, it's not just one, I can take it to all these different spots and show you. At the time of the end, verse 40, shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him. Well, that's Ken's sermon, so I won't go there, okay? I'll leave that with Ken. Ken will show you what happened when, and what the Pope just did that you probably did not catch, and you missed it, right? I won't say anymore. I can see your eyes. And, what did he do? He'll deal with that later. But I want you to think for a moment and just see that this is where we are. This is where we are. And then if you look at how Jesus lines this up, he says, then is going to come a time when this gospel of the kingdom, verse 14, shall be preached in all the world. For what, beloved? A witness unto all nations. He said, then shall the end come. Something is going to happen that you say, see? That's what Jesus said would have happened. Then the world will turn and say, what? Go read. 2,000 years ago, it was penned for you to see. He must have been a prophet. Come on, 2,000 years ago? Of course, he is. He says this is what would happen. And he says, then the gospel is going to explode. Why? They'll have a witness. A witness. I mean, I'm going to tell you this. We say in the Dark Ages how that the blood of the saints was like seed. You don't understand what's going to happen, what's taking place right now, the sowing, all the seed of Christians' blood and so. You don't see it yet. But if it happened then, why will it not happen again? If the blood of martyrs then were like seed and people were just accepting and joining and becoming a part of the body, why will it not happen today? All right, so let me just recap a little bit on what we have already mentioned. The sequence of events is clear. False Christ appears. Now, fulfilled or not fulfilled? First one. False Christ appear. Fulfilled or not fulfilled? Yeah. Fulfilled. And is being fulfilled. Present continuous. Okay. Wars, rumors of wars. Fulfilled or not fulfilled?
Fulfilled.
And is fulfilling. Famines, pestilences, earthquakes.
Fulfilled.
How about fearful sights and signs from heaven? All right, let's stop there for a moment, since you did not say anything. Right? We were saying fulfill. So now we hit another one, and then not sure about that one yet. All right. Solar flares. What are those?
Explosions on the surface of the sun.
Okay. Happened before? Always happening, right?
Yeah.
All through our history, right?
Right.
Okay. Why then a big news item? If it's always happening, then why then are we having these scary thoughts and what might happen and what can be as a result? I'm going to say something to you. I'm not a scientist. Okay? I told you, I'm not a conspiracy theorist, and I'm not a scientist. Don't mix me up. I am a son of God. My eyes are open. I'm simply just looking. And I'm telling you what I'm seeing. Is that reasonable? Just give me that label. I like that one. Okay? I'm just like you. A child of God. Isn't that good? Yes. I've looked at this issue of solar flares. And you know, somewhere, Ken, you know, sometimes in my mind, I'm thinking, he caused a fire to fall down from heaven in the sight of men. Now, I'm not saying that it's solar flares. Don't get me mistaken here, right? But my mind goes there. It's how my mind works, right? I'm thinking about these things, and I'm saying, these things, and I'm saying, I wonder what that means, right? But that's symbolic, right? But we're dealing with something here that is really interesting and important. The effect of the solar flares coming into our atmosphere is what? All right, I'm sorry. All right, I was thinking everybody knew this, but it seemed like I'm wrong, right? So, but here's what's happening. The electromagnetic field is disturbed, right? And so we have polar shifts when this happens. Now, there are things that are happening that are unexplainable. And I'm not saying I'm explaining it. It's in my own mind, I'm working this out. Sorry for that. But, right? I'm working this out. And this is it. As the magnetic pole shifts, then we begin to see the destructions from things that depend on compass to move. For example, we're seeing fishes dying off by the millions. Isn't that true? We're seeing tons of fish dying off. Not just fishes, dolphins, whales. I mean, these are not necessarily on the major news anymore because there's no answer. Birds are falling from the skies. Hurricanes and tornadoes are the biggest we've ever seen in history. Who's from Oklahoma? Jim. Category 5, isn't that right? We prayed for you, man. That's why you're safe. But I mean, just think. So I'm simply saying these things that are happening are having effect, and sometimes we don't put it together. We don't say, okay, this is as a result of this, right? Okay, and maybe it's not. But we see rivers turning to blood. It happened in China twice. It happened in Vancouver just the other day. In Australia, in New Zealand.
In Florida this week.
See, she's up to date. What are these? Jesus says, fearful sights, right? Is that making sense? Then there are these sounds that are coming up from the earth and nobody knows. And these sounds that are coming from the skies and no clue. And somebody says, that's harp at work. Don't ask me what it means. I'm just telling what I hear. But it's happening. And these things are not common occurrences. That's why they're alarming. They are not common occurrences. Sinkholes are opening up in the ground. In Florida alone, over 250 last year. And they're counting this year, they're probably over 100. What are these? What are causing these things? Houses are just collapsing. I have a video in Kazakhstan, or Kyrgyzstan it could be, where this lady was in her home and she had a two-week-old baby and she said she felt something strange, like the house was vibrating, and she grabbed the baby and ran out just in time to see the house disappear. I mean, it's happening. These are happening. Fearful sights are taking place around the world. Why are these happening? It's time. He's saying, it's time. We see a world that is dying. Look here, let me not even go to the economy, right? I'm a visitor, I know. Brother, I went to buy a bread, and I bought a bread. This is America, right? And he said, Brother Webb says, isn't it cheaper in Jamaica, man?
Come on. You mean a third world country have food cheaper? It's Walmart, man.
But I mean, I can feel what happens in your economy, even as a visitor. Because what I normally spend and what we normally come out with is always more and smaller, you know?
You know what I believe on this, but I'll just share it with you again, just to remind you.
How many plagues were there in Egypt?
Ah, how many?
Uh-huh. All right, so there were 10 plagues in Egypt. Did you know that the first three fell in Goshen? Did you know that? Did you know that God's people were affected by the first three plagues? Did you know that the first three plagues affected the river? And the agricultural economy was devastated because of it? Did you know that? Did you know that in my own view of things, the first three plagues has to do with the economy?
You didn't know, I'm telling you. What did the Bible say in Revelation, the seven last plague? Why do you use the word last if that's the only ones? It doesn't make sense, does it? Anyway, just something for you to think about. I won't even go there.
So, here's something I would want to just mention, which I think, in my own mind, I think is the most astonishing move that has ever been made. It has to do with man. The defacing of God in man. Well, you know, science is the new God, because there is no God except science. But there's something that is called transhumanism. Ever heard the word? It's really the amalgamation of animals and human, where they're doing all these experimenting of using animal DNA and combining it with man. I was wrong about something. One time I said, this is impossible. And I stood strong because I had evidence. Genesis 1 says, each shall produce after its kind. Is that true? Isn't that what it says? But I recognize in the natural realm, it's impossible. In the natural realm, it's impossible for a man to mate with a monkey and produce a monkey. Okay? So, this is the point. On the genetic level, is it possible? Now, maybe that's something I didn't think about, but I recognize it is. I recognize why you can use genes from fish and put them in tomato and grow them in winter. So I recognize on certain levels this can be done. And in transhumanism, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to produce a superhuman. And all the movies is to tell you that man can be bionic and man can be super. We can make a better product than God made. Did you know that? I've seen experiments where they actually produce a frog and a human combined baby. And you know, these don't normally live too long. You know that. This entire thing of experimentation with God's creation, as far as I can see, is one of the most deadly. Then they're trying to create their own. Asimo! Heard the name? Asimo. Oh, I thought I got a wrong pronunciation. That's a Japanese reproduction. That's their best robot so far. Didn't you see your president go down to Japan and was playing soccer with that thingy? We welcome you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
That's where we are. The name of God, the name of God is dishonored. And the people of God are silent. They speak in whispers. We know God is going to do something one day.
How?
That's where we are. Then, this GMO thing. Oh, I heard they released a new banana in the U.S. just the other day. With a lot more vitamin A. See? And they're coming with a new rice with beta carotene. You don't have to eat the carrot, just get some rice. It's the truth. And then what is happening with man? Just consider for a moment what's going on with man. I've looked at some disturbing pictures. Do you understand? If you're here and you have a tattoo on your body, I'm not talking about you. And I know in our ignorance we do lots of things. But I'm simply saying, look at what's going on with these tattooing. I mean, they're gone to 3D images now. And you've seen some of those. I see men implanting horns in their foreheads. Does that make sense to you? I mean, somehow the devil is really destroying God's creation. Really. But why is that so? Why is that so? I'm going to tell you why. Because I have not lived the light that I am. I did not say you. I did not blame you. I have not lived like I ought to have lived. I have not brought joy and happiness and gladness to the world in showing the reality that I am a son and that the world can see there's a difference. The world can see there's a better way. That's what I was ordained for. I was ordained to live. Oh, did Jesus say, let your light. You can finish it. Let your light so shine before men that they may what? See him working in you and be led to glorify my Father which is in heaven. But they have not seen that. They have seen quarrels and bickerings among us. And they're saying, are these Christians? They can't be. And we can quote the verse from now till next year. By this shall all men know you can't produce love. I have tried it. It never worked. You cannot produce love. Love has to be implanted. It has to be implanted in you. The being called God, his own spirit has to come in you. Because that is love. When love comes in me, then I become love. I don't try to love. I don't want to love you, but I hate you. I'm doing my best. No, that doesn't work. That's religion, and we said we're done with it. Isn't it? Why are we submitting to it? And there is Beamageddon. I saw the term recently, and I thought interesting. Beamageddon. So you know Armageddon. He's saying this: the bees are dying off. And nobody knows why, but you're dying off. I'm reminded of a statement. I'll just read it for you. If the bee disappears, now listen to this carefully. If the bee disappeared off the face of the globe, then man would only have 4 years of life left. No more bees, no more pollination, no more plants, no more animals, no more man. Who said those words? Oh, you never heard them before. Sorry. It's Einstein. Albert Einstein actually said that. Flesh and blood did not reveal that. Come on. But just for you to know, I'm throwing some things at you. And don't you get offended with me. I love you. You know that. I just want us to keep our eyes in the right place. And maybe we have just been looking in different areas. Maybe we are just not recognizing that we are right down in the end. Maybe, just maybe, our focus has been diverted somewhat. And all I'm asking you to come back. This reality. I'm going to close. I'm going to use a passage and we just close off with this. Luke 21 is a good place to go back to. Luke 21. Let's get down towards the end of Luke 21. Verse signs of the time. Let's get down to verse 34. Are we there? And take heed to yourselves. Who is he talking to? Me. Lest at any time your hearts become what, beloved? Overcharged with what? Surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life. Come on. Here is something legitimate. The cares of this life. The legitimate cares. Mortgage, rent, food, survival. Think about it. It's legitimate. But he says we can, our hearts can be overcharged with these things. What is he saying? I'll tell you what I think he's saying. You might not necessarily agree, but I'll tell you what I think he's saying. He's saying, I am your father. I provide for you. Why are you worried? See, we live like we have no father. You should see my kids, how they live. I look at these kids. I mean, no care in the world. Mommy, I'm hungry. And they're around the table, chair pulled. That's it. What do you think is going to happen? You're going to stay there? Nope. Very soon, food. Thanks, Mommy. Do we have a father like that? Is our father like that? How do we prove him? Now he's saying, take heed. He's saying, beware. That's the word, really. Beware, lest your heart become overcharged. And you're thinking, I have to provide for myself. I have to provide for my family. I have to... Come on, who are you? Can you provide? No. Everything comes from him. But sometimes we forget. Most times we forget. And then he says, and so that day comes upon you unawares. See, that's the issue. That's the issue. You become so overcharged and so concerned about everything else, accepting the reality of that day coming upon you, and you're not aware. Are we there? Am I there? Four. 35, for as a snare, as a what, beloved?
Snare.
For as a snare shall it come upon all those that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Who is that? Who is that? Let me ask you something. I like this idea of snare. I'm going to close, David. I see you standing, and I know that means I'm over time. Now, let me ask you something. What's a snare? A trap. Okay. You know, as a boy, you know, my dad had an orchard, orange orchard, you know, and sometimes, I mean, as a family, if we're not selling as a family, we won't be able to eat all these oranges. So most times we'll have oranges falling off the tree. They're overripe, right? And so we have lots of seeds on the ground most times. And then birds would come to get the seeds. This is interesting because we'd always set our traps to catch birds. Do you know what we use as bait? Food. I won't say any more. Just think about that. Our bait has always been food. I see people going out to catch fish. What's on the hook?
Food.
Watch therefore. Let me close. Watch therefore. 36. Watch therefore. And pray always. Why? Oh, you're not there. Thought you were with me. Let's go again. Watch therefore and pray always. Why? That you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass
and stand before the Son of Man. Is that good counsel? Is that good counsel? Watch, therefore, and pray always. You can cut the tape, David. That's it. Think about this for a moment. Are you watching? Be honest. Here's where you have to be super honest with yourself. See, I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help you. So let's be super honest. Are we watching? Are we watching unto prayer? Was that the first term we used earlier? You remember that one? When you shall see these things come to pass? Are we watching unto prayer? Are we watching with an awareness? That's watching. Watching means this, an awareness. When my kids were smaller, my wife was like that. Her eyes were like an arc. Hark. Crow. She's everywhere. Where are they? She knows. And even in her peripherals, she knew what was going on. There was an interest there. That's my baby. How about us? What are we, honestly, what is it that is taking most of our attention? Be honest before God. I'm not asking you to tell me. I'm just saying, think about this in your heart as we talk, because we're going to go to God and we're going to ask Him to help us. We're going to ask, because we are in need. I am in need, even if you're not. I am in need of this reality, to be more and more in my reality. You with me? What is it that occupies your mind most of the time? What is it that you think about most of the time? There's a reason. Because somehow whatever you think about most of the time has your attention. You with me? Jesus wants to do something. I'm tired. I'm tired of living for me. Are you? I'm tired of living my own life. I'm tired of having my dreams and my this and not anything of Him or for Him. Come on, He has called us to be stewards of Him, to lift Him up before others. But we have not been doing it. Even though we want to do it. Is that ironic or what? We're not doing it, but yes, we want to do it. And He knows in our hearts we want to do it. Because every time His Spirit comes and speaks, you're convicted. And you say, God, I want to. I want to. But there are things that have taken over my life and have wrapped me up and tangled me up like a spider's web. And sometimes I can't break loose. Is that happening to you? Then He says He can break any yoke. He says He can set you free today. He says if you come to Him and you're honest in your heart and you just leave it at His feet, He says He will take care and He will make it better. And that's what I want. Is that what you want? Amen. We're going to pray. We're going to kneel before Him. And if He's moving on your heart and you want to just cry out before Him and say, Father, help me, I'm sure you will hear. And if you want to do it on behalf of all of us, then great. If you're impressed this way, as we kneel, just talk to Him. Tell Him what's going on. Because He wants to be your Father. Amen. Let's pray.
Thank you for watching the video. I hope you have been blessed. In fact, I hope you have been greatly blessed. If this presentation has been helpful to you, you can help others to find this channel and to interact with these videos simply by hitting the like or dislike button, and even better, by subscribing to our channel. So I want to encourage you now to just hit the subscribe button and subscribe. It will be a great help. And if you'd like, please, I invite you to visit our website at www.restorationministry.com. www.thebiblestudy.com. In fact, why not join us on Facebook? Every day we try to put up something helpful, some little thoughts, some little information that can be helpful to people. So it would be nice if you join us there. The address is www.facebook.com/restorationministriesja. Thank you. God bless you. Looking forward to seeing more of you again soon.